is about ready to leave.
Good morning.
Welcome to the 50th annual J. Walter Porter Forum. We're honoring our past, celebrating the present, and building the future. The present defines the future. The future builds on the foundation of the past. You are the best author of your future. So the next time you sit down to write your own story, remember, you are the creator of the best chapters that could ever be written. It is through the generous donations of the late J. Walter Porter's family members and friends that we are able to provide this venue for you. It was Mr. Porter's vision to improve the image of business as a career field for college students by providing this forum a way of linking capable, successful business executives to our students, our faculty members, and the business community. It is our hope that this forum will help connect the classroom theory with real-world application. Today, I would like to welcome some of the Porter family members who are here with us today. Mr. Bud Porter, Ms. Patsy Porter, and Mr. Bill Porter. Will you please stand? We are just so excited and thrilled that you're able to join us here today for the 50th anniversary. Next, I would like to introduce Dr. Jim Henderson, our president, to welcome you here. Dr. Henderson.
Thank you very much, Dr. Kilcoin, and thank you to the Porter family for your presence today and for your ongoing support of this wonderful program. And what an incredible topic to talk about today. You've got two amazing speakers who both have been extraordinarily successful in their own right. But I'm so glad that you're here because you are our future. We're going to talk about the future in terms of technology and business, but I want you to understand something. Your generation, like my generation, and like the generation that came before me, is often criticized by those that are more senior than you. I want you to know what I've observed about your generation is you come to college, you work in your communities with a sense of social conscience that has eluded many generations before you. You come with an ethical foundation and a philosophical foundation that's going to make you very successful for the greater good. But that only works if you invest in yourself like you're doing by your presence here today. It's vitally important. You know, in technology, you're going to hear so much about technology, and so don't poo-poo any of the statistics I give them, because I promise you they're correct or close to it. But this phone, together with this watch, is 250,000 times more powerful than the computer I used when I was a student at Northwestern. 250,000 times more powerful. You think about what the impact of those advances in technology are. I just saw a commercial for BP oil. Everybody's heard of BP because of the oil spill. And so they're doing lots of public relations to try to repurpose their image. But this commercial was about how they're using a drone to do deep analytics in their offshore platforms, evaluating the efficiency of the operation, the safety of the equipment, any number of measures of how that operation is working. That work used to be done by a person or a team of people, now being done more effectively, more safely, less expensively with technology. Technology is going to change everything about the world you live in. Uber is moving to a driverless fleet. Think about this. You will never teach your children how to drive. Not in the way that we did. It will change everything about your world. I'm going to sum this up real quickly. You will be prepared for that because you have this ethical and philosophical foundation, but also because you're at a university that is giving you not only a degree in business or CIS or whatever field you're in, you're also going to learn how to think critically, you're going to learn how to solve problems, and you're going to learn how to communicate effectively. When you take those core competencies, with the ability to continue learning, you're going to be very, very successful. So thank you for being here today. Thank you again to the Porter family, to our speakers. We're so looking forward to your message here today. Dr. Kilcorn, thank you for your leadership of this wonderful College of Business and Technology. Enjoy the Walter Porter Forum. Forkum Demons.
We also have some other guests with us from across campus. We have Dr. Maggio, Mr. Drake, and we have Mr. Ted Jones, our Regus Chair. Would you please stand? Of course, I could not have pulled all this off, and I didn't, because I had some fabulous faculty and staff that helped me. So would the faculty and staff of the College of Business and Technology please stand so we can thank you for your support? Thank y'all so much for helping out with this. Before we begin with our speakers, I would like to give you a brief overview of what's going to happen today. After our first speaker, we will take a break and return back to Miguel at about 10:55 for the next speaker. And then after that speaker, we will move across the courtyard and the street to Russell Hall, where we will have pizza for our students who would like to have some pizza. And then we will have the luncheon for our guests, our speakers, the Porter family, and our seniors in the Natchitoches room. Then, if you're free at 2 p.m., we will have Miss Corinne Hoisington speak again at 2 p.m. in room 107, the David Morgan room of Russell Hall. So please join us again if you would like. Now, Miss Melissa Aldridge will introduce our first speaker. Ms. Aldridge?
Good morning. My name is Melissa Aldridge, and I'm an assistant professor of accounting in the College of Business and Technology. I, too, would like to thank the Porter family for this great gathering. We look forward to it every year, and this year is no different. It's so special to have a 50th anniversary and have two great speakers to look forward to. It is my pleasure to introduce your first speaker, Professor Corinne Hoisington. She comes to us from Central Virginia Community College, where she's a full-time professor of information technology. Professor Hoisington has been teaching for over 25 years, but she's also a highly sought-after speaker. She travels all over the world each year on speaking engagements, and she's even been awarded Microsoft's Most Valuable Professional in Computer Programming Award. She's also authored over 20 textbooks, and I can say I've had the privilege of hearing her speak, and she is so dynamic. She knows everything you need to know about new and innovative ways to use technology, and she relates it in such a fun and understandable way. You guys are in for a real treat. Please join me in welcoming Professor Corinne Hoisington.
Well, everybody, good morning. How we doing?
I got this feeling.
We are going to kick it up. Are you ready? I am honored to be here to meet the Porters today. Thank you so much for letting me be a part of today's celebration. I'm Corinne Hoisington, and I can't wait to show you what the future looks like. But we must remember the past, the present, to be able to understand the future. So let's get into the groove a little bit. Are you ready? Come on. Real quick, I teach computer IT and technology and business in Virginia, and I also write a few textbooks, and I want to share with you, though, what I'm most proud of. I'm most proud of my family. I'm the mother of six children, for real. Yes, they came one at a time. Why do people keep asking that? Not Octomom, okay? I have four sons and two daughters, and they've all graduated from the university. Are you happy?
I am.
Okay? And they're starting to be fruitful and multiply. So I have two little grandchildren, but there has been excitement in my house in the last few weeks. My oldest daughter, who's standing next to me, is my favorite right now, right? She's been the mother, and just in the last couple weeks, welcome baby number three. So is that not cool? So what will their future look like, and yours as well? You know, business and technology is changing at the fastest pace that I've ever seen. And as we go through and show you a glimpse of the future, I want you to think, students, what jobs could I get into that are going to be growing with this new future in business and technology? Because the future is bright. It's kind of like this. I want to kind of open the door over the next half hour of maybe what the future looks like. And imagine this. I want you to imagine the future is knocking at your dorm door. Now the future looks a tad high maintenance. Let's go on a quick speed date of what the future looks like. High maintenance, right? So let's stretch out a little bit, peek into the future. We'll even have lunch today. Come on, let her in. And maybe there'll be some apps along the way too. So let's kind of peek that door of the future open. The first thing we're really going to see in the next 5 to 10 years that will change your future is automation. I mean, a lot of people who don't go to college, there's always been jobs for those who aren't as highly skilled of those who graduate from the university here. But I have to tell you something, Northwestern, you better get ready. There's going to be more students applying than ever because there's going to be more highly skilled positions opening and not so many unskilled. So we better get ready because this is going to be the ticket to employment. I mean, we're seeing automated cars. You couldn't have given me a better segue, Dr. Henderson, that we're seeing out there. I mean, in the next few years, we're going to see self-driving cars everywhere.
It was a big decision for us to go and start building our purpose-built vehicles for this. And really, they're prototype vehicles. They were a chance for us to explore what does it really mean to have a self-driving vehicle. But in the small amount of time we've been working on it, you know, we have functional prototypes, and that's exciting.
It's really cool. It was like really kind of a space age experience.
Oh, okay. Hooray. No steering wheel?
You said relax. You don't need to do nothing. It knows when it needs to stop. It knows when it needs to go.
It actually rides better than my own car.
Yes, sure.
What she really liked was that it slowed down before it went around a curve and then accelerated
in the curve.
She's always trying to get me to do it that way.
That's the way I learned in a high school driver's ed.
So if I had a self-driving car, I could spend more time hanging out with my kids or helping them with their homework, even just tending to them, finding out how their day was and not having to wait till you get home and have dinner and all that. So it'll be good.
Human feeling of it is very well engineered and it is very smooth. There's nothing that makes you feel the least bit threatened. It's impressive. I'm totally in love with this whole concept.
our lives are made up of lots and lots of little things. And a lot of those little things for most people have to do with
the gentleman that you're seeing now is legally blind.
Be with people.
He's never in his life been able to drive by himself.
And so there's a big part of my
life. Can you imagine the opportunities?
And
even as we get older, we won't have to be dependent on others. We could still get around.
And it's really exciting to see the progress we've made.
And imagine this. No more drunk driving. No more needless accidents. I mean, that's huge. Just think, you might not ever train your children to drive. I mean, think of big cities like New Orleans. You wouldn't need parking lots anymore, right? Come on. So all those kinds of things would no longer be necessary. You say, Corinne, this is 20, 50 years. We'll all be old people before this hits. Guess what? In the next year, we're going to see driverless Ubers, Ford, Tesla, tons of other companies in the next 1 to 4 years are having their first self-driving cars come out. Insurance will be dropped significantly. How many would like not to pay that? We're also seeing trucking. Remember our discussion on jobs and positions? Think of how many people are employed today with driving. A lot. Do you know that in Europe right now, that they just had the first 10 trucks go across 8 European countries 3 months ago? And guess what? No driver. They actually saved 10% on the gas because they can get behind each other and draft perfectly. I mean, that's crazy. Right now, legally, a driver in the United States can drive 10 hours a day. How long could these things drive? 24 hours, right? You say, who will pump the gas? Most of the trucking stations already pump it for you, so no problem there. So now, that will change. And if we could cut out the $60,000 to $80,000 they pay truck drivers, do you see that happening? And what else? Well, I can't wait to fly to Pittsburgh, let me tell you. And by the way, this is happening in Louisiana very soon. Uber, in many cities, is already going driverless. So your Uberless driver comes and picks you up, but no driver. So the cost will be much cheaper, and hopefully no accidents, because these are much safer than traditional. By the way, if you're in one of these cities right now, Uber is doing the driverless car for free. So if you could happen to pick up in that Uber, no cost to you. Within the next year, Uber plans to do this in 25 major cities in the United States. This is not 10 years into the future. This is now. Look how the car is facing. Wouldn't it be great that you can actually see each other? It's like a limousine. I'm in. What else? Well, Ford and many other companies are putting these out. There'll even be kits for your car in the next year or two that can replace your steering wheel with a driverless system for under $2,000. So this isn't something that's so far away. This is immediately into our future. And I've got to show you this. In the United States, in 2017 is next year, everybody. Three cities, Washington in Seattle, also in Washington, D.C., and also in New York City, they're trying these new little buses. This is already in Finland. They hold 12 people, no driver whatsoever. And a lot of college campuses are already looking into this just to move around campus as well. So who knows? Very soon we'll have city buses, no drivers, and you can just get on and off. Pretty neat. And a lot of them are electric power, so they're not using gas and pollution as well. You know, we're seeing everything change, but I've got to show you what else is changing. Notice I've got a couple pieces of equipment up on the stage. You know, we're also seeing in business in the future, and today even, that we're starting to see virtual reality and augmented reality changing the game. And it's more than just gaming. It's business as we know it. Well, let me show you. I know on campus that you all have a Google Cardboard set already, but I brought the other two. I have a ViewMaster. How many remember the ViewMaster when you were kids, maybe? Who had one of these? Come on, raise hands. Okay, what was on your little wheel with the pictures? Remind me. What pictures was it? Yeah, zoo animals. Okay, he says Grand Canyon. He was the rich kid, okay? So, all those kinds of things. But now they have a new one. I also have with me an Oculus Rift. So let me kind of show you what's going on with these. So the first one I want to show you
is kind of like 80s.
Is the ViewMaster VR. But I'm going to have someone join me. Come, she's like, please don't pick me. Come around, my dear. And you're going to help me out, show everybody. While she's coming out, check this out.
So before you look at it, look at the front and you'll see that there's a phone in there.
Oh, okay, so you put your phone in there.
Is that a trigger?
Yep, there's your trigger. Same thing.
Can I put it on now?
Go for it. Tell us what you see.
All right, let's see.
Oh, that's freaking awesome. Look at that.
Whoa. Oh my God, I can look around?
Oh, wow, it keeps going.
Let's see, elephants and drinking water. I feel like I'm standing there.
Elephants, zebras.
Oh, and you can see the sun too. Wow.
No one's gonna go outside anymore.
Yeah, it still looks kind of like.
Nobody is going to go outside anymore. So I'm gonna have you hold that. So what I'm gonna do is take any kind of phone, iPhone, Android phone, and I'm gonna put it inside the ViewMaster. These are only like $19 at Toys R Us. So I'm going to put it inside, and let me get this ready for her. So go ahead inside there. Tell us what you're seeing.
I see zebras and a lake and...
Look up. Is it a pretty day?
Yeah, it's bright. It's pretty. The sun's out.
Now, look all behind you. Come all around.
Oh.
Now notice right here, there's a little place to click. Do you feel that little
yes.
orange button right there? So click that when you see little circles. So this allows you to kind of go in. We call this virtual reality. Why? She can't see us right now. Can you see the audience right now? No. She's in her own little world. Virtual reality means you're kind of encased. And there are literally thousands of apps now available to kind of go into this environment. But I also show you AR. So I'm going to have her take that down from her eyes and then share it with the crowd. So walk out and start sharing that with everybody to play. All right. And let me show you the next one. Let me kind of take it on a bigger roll. In fact, sir, come up next to him. So let me show you the Oculus Rift real quick.
So, another one of my own turns out to be Divergent.
What?
Driver's Ed. The Oculus Rift runs anywhere from $80 for the Samsung Gear. On up. Facebook owns this. You can even take a yoga class to chill out. You could even go to a concert. And you look a little weird. Well, let's find out. So who are you real quick?
Kyle.
Kyle. Do you mind looking weird? Not just for a moment, right?
I guess. Okay,
everybody say, go Kyle. So hold that. I'm going to put this on your head. If you want to adjust it now with your hands. All right, what are you seeing?
Fish.
Fish? What else? Look up, around, look all behind you now. Sir, I don't have insurance, so don't fall. Describe to them what you're seeing.
A shark.
You're seeing a shark, sir. I didn't put a shark in there.
That's fine.
Swim away, sir. Are you afraid?
A little bit.
So he's in a shark cage under the water, right off the Gulf. Is that okay? So what do you think? Pretty realistic?
Yes.
Well, we're going to have him take it off and show and everybody in the audience. But I want to kind of show you this week, another device came out. I can't wait to get my hands on it. It'll be in the stores tomorrow. Google is coming out with their version called The Daydream for just $74. What do you think? And you can put in any Android phone, come in three colors. And what's different about the Google Daydream, it comes with a control so that you can actually interact more so. Cool? Now you're probably thinking, how is this going to change business? Well, I'm going to head there in just a moment. Do you see the sharks? What do you think? So, how are we going to survive all this change?
What happened? A unit ambushed an assassin with a spear.
Sacrebleu. Do you ever feel like this some days?
I'm glad you're okay, my old friend.
I was the only one to survive.
Well, there's going to be a lot of change. But we're seeing this change everywhere.
ABC announced it will offer 85 hours of virtual reality Olympics, programming.
They actually recorded the entire NBC Olympics that were in Rio de Janeiro just last month. They actually had 3D cameras at the Olympics. And the entire Olympics are now on free apps in the Oculus Rift. And you can actually, you're not just watching a flat screen of some episode or some event. You're actually running down on the pommel right behind the male gymnast, ready to hop up there. It's almost disconcerting to some ways, but very cool. So how is this changing?
What if we could go beyond
the screen? Well, everybody look up on the screen right now.
Where? What if we could go
and look at these goggles. This is called the HoloLens. Let me show you the difference. What we've seen so far is called VR. Everybody remind me what VR is. Virtual reality. But what I'm about to now show you is, I think, has even greater potential in our future. It's called augmented reality. So you still wear goggles, although Microsoft is working on something without goggles very soon. But you can see out of the goggles. Your phone's not there. It just works with a Windows 10 computer in the room. And it puts holograms into your space. You see the real world, but you see holograms superimposed on what you're looking at. Everybody look up on my screen. Do you all see the big screen TV up there? That big screen TV is not a big screen TV. It's a hologram. And I got to tell you a quick little personal story. I've got a great husband. I remember about 5 years ago, us going to like Best Buy to shop for our first flat screen TV for over the fireplace in the living room. I remember it was clearly a Samsung 27-inch. Well, we put it up on top of the fireplace, looks great. I go out and speak once in a while, come back, and I look at that TV, and it looked larger. And I said to my husband, is that the same TV? And he'd say, yeah, it's a Samsung. Okay. Well, the other day I came home, it was massive. I got up on a chair, measured, it is now 51 inches. I said, honey, that is not the same TV. He says, it's a Samsung. Everybody watch in 5 seconds to understand why there won't be any flat screen TVs very quickly. The HoloLens is coming out this fall, and what we're starting to see here is that our world is changing.
The world is blended with your real world. Now we can. This
look
is
how
the world
he
with
takes
holograms.
The TV. Everybody, can you do that? All right.
What will they enable us to do?
So now businesses, when
new
they're designing new
work.
Products,
I
can go to proof of design
tank.
Instantly.
New ways to share ideas with each other.
How are things going your end?
I just put the images in OneDrive.
Perfect.
Your entire classroom will become like a holodeck.
Play.
This is coming out in the next couple months.
So put the new trap in the
place.
Wow,
what an exciting future.
Now what?
And tighten here and here.
New ways to collaborate and explore the places we've never been.
Look at this formation. Let's take a closer look.
Now next, look at a little boy coloring with crayons.
And new ways to create the things we imagine.
He drew a rocket, and in seconds later, Dad is designing it as a hologram that will be printed out within 1 hour on a 3D printer.
You can
talk about
the world you see.
Proof of concept so quickly. Everybody look at the dog in the bottom right-hand corner. Does anybody see something different? This is the perfect hollow dog, okay? No food. All right. Right now on the International Space Station, flying over us right now, they already have 5 hollow lenses, but they're going to be in a store soon. We don't know pricing yet, but they've already released 30,000 hollow lenses to developers to start coding in every possible field. Well, let me kind of show you where this is heading. I want to show you what's happening in the medical field. Tomorrow I'm going to head over to the campus in Shreveport and show some of the nurses this same piece. There's a school up in Cleveland, Ohio called Case Western. And this fall they gave every nursing and medical student a HoloLens. And they put this on their face and they can, with their hands, see every piece of the anatomy up close. They are now developing MRI machines. Is let's say you have a heart ailment. You'll go in the MRI, and with the hour, they'll show a hologram of your heart beating 3D so that you can view what's happening inside. I mean, it's kind of like this. This is changing our game.
Illustrations, and it's completely two-dimensional, and the human body isn't.
Microsoft HoloLens is a holographic computer that you wear. It enables you to bring your digital world into your real world.
At Case Western Reserve University, we are focused on solving problems and creating new knowledge.
My job is to teach, and I really think this could impact almost everything that we teach people. With HoloLens, you can see the muscles on top of the
skeleton.
Instead
of just seeing a flat, two-dimensional picture in a book.
And exactly understand where things sit.
Look at this.
You can take any anatomical part and show any of it. You can move it around. You can make it kind of translucent so you can see through the outside. And that really helped me understand like how cardiac anatomy worked. I actually had a moment where I found the aortic valve.
Look at the heart.
And it was the first
beating.
Time that I'd actually seen the aortic valve in relation to all the other anatomical structures. You know, it was a way of seeing it that you couldn't do with an actual heart.
You know, we're seeing a world that allows you to do
anything.
The HoloLens
is absolutely the most amazing piece of technology. Within 5 seconds, I realized that the world had changed. It was an immediate realization that this is something exciting and we have to be a part of this. Seeing things in 3D is something that you could do before with some glasses. The thing that the HoloLens gives you is the ability to walk around those 3D objects and to really experience them as if they're in the room with you.
It is augmented reality, it is mixed reality. And what that means is I still see you, I still see this room and everything around me, but the digital content is inserted into.
So let me kind of show you where this is going. I do some training for Microsoft once in a while, and they ask me, this is what we're working on, but don't tell anybody. What happens here, can it stay here? Okay? Now, I'm going to get permission real quick. Is it okay if I go off academic script? Okay, we got it. How many are football fans? Come on, people. Hands up. Well, you're going to be if you're not now. Let me show you what Microsoft is planning for Super Bowl 51 this February. So imagine this. It is game day. Everybody is coming over to your place for the big game. Now, sorry that they're wearing the wrong jerseys in this picture. Clearly, they don't know. Now, these people have a sad little flat screen TV. But don't worry, we don't have to watch it on that. The entire wall becomes the game. You tap on the screen, the entire stadium comes into your living room. Amazing. You tap on a player and the fantasy stats of that player pops into the room. Now, forget bobbleheads. We can actually ask the players to the party. We could throw a few balls here. Are we liking football more? And you know that play that the ref called all wrong? Why not put it on the coffee table, go walk around it, and prove that they called that wrong for our team? Guys, this is what's happening by February. What do you think?
I've got a video.
So our world is changing, guys, but I got to show you what's happening right now. Everyone's heard of Volvo, right?
Realities around you.
You can now go to any Volvo dealership today.
You can see the soul of the
car. They already have the HoloLens.
You
look what happens.
You can strip the body out and stay with the skeleton, and you can play around with it.
The HoloLens can allow our customers to see features, colors, options.
You can pick out
so
your whole car.
Rather than working on the computer, seeing things, you can be part of the experience.
Now, what's Volvo known for?
No one understands how car sensors actually work today. Through the HoloLens, you can see how the car perceives you.
This
and then
changes
me
business
as a human
entirely.
Being, the vantage point of a sensor. It helps to build a much better trust in these type of systems.
For example, you see a car coming in front of you. The car has features that could aid in that situation. We have a lot of features that we don't necessarily want you to experience it all, but it's part of our proposition. You're buying into the safest car brand in the world.
One of the great things that was said to us by Volvo when we started this was that Volvo loves technology, but only if it makes people's lives simpler. Microsoft HoloLens lets people take imagination and make it real much more efficiently and in a much more collaborative manner.
HoloLens will not only help us in the car buying process at the dealership, it can evolve into many areas. We think there are many alternative applications of this tool in the future, and Volvo clearly has an aspiration to break out of the pack.
It's cool.
Okay, let's all repeat. What is it, everybody? It's cool, for sure. But let me show you what else is happening right now. We have stores like Lowe's. In the next 2 weeks, almost every Lowe's in the country is getting a HoloLens. Now, here's how it works. Let's say you're looking at redesigning your kitchen. Big business, lots of money. So what they're asking you to do in the next 2 weeks is just grab your phone, take a quick picture of your kitchen as is. With me? You then bring your phone in, they email the digital picture to Lowe's, and then they put your kitchen inside as a hologram in the HoloLens. And then you click on different surfaces, different countertops, and it changes everything. Let me show you what this looks like. So now you can head to Lowe's here real quick, and let me show you your new experience. Instead of walking around the store imagining what it would look like, you can turn your imagination into reality. So here is her kitchen, but with the new surfaces, new countertops, new pulls, new wood. Everything is a hologram. Do you think that will change buying habits? Yeah, so often it's hard for us to imagine what it really will look like. What almost every school in the country is now looking at is even in their programming classes and coding classes, you can now program the HoloLens right in class. I mean, this is just changing how we do things.
Type of capture technology.
But let me finish with this. Holoportation. You say, like, beam me up, Scotty. You got it. So let me set this up. This gentleman is in Redmond, Washington. And I don't know if you can see it around the room, but there are three 3D cameras. Do you see them up on the pedestals? 3D cameras are now about $300 or less. They're not crazy expensive like they used to be. So soon, instead of inviting me to come speak, maybe my hologram can just show up. It'll save me a plane ride. Let me show you. This man is in Redmond, Washington, but he actually lives in Istanbul, Turkey. And his little 4-year-old daughter is at home today in Istanbul, Turkey. But they took this room. Do you see right now there's a carpet, a little orange bench, a little wood table in the center, and recreated it in her home in Istanbul, his home. And let me show you what happens right here.
It's in our lab. And she's going to holoport into my space, and I'm going to interact with her wearing my HoloLens.
Hi, Bob, I miss you.
Hey, Lily, I miss
she's
you,
she's coming in 10,000 miles away.
I'm coming home very soon. Let me get out of your way.
Now, she wouldn't wear the HoloLens, so she can't see him, only hear him.
Hey, Lilia, you can only hear me, you can't see me, but what are these toys?
I have toys to show you. This one, his name is Elmo.
Elmo?
And he can sing.
He can sing, wow. And what about the other one?
The other one is called Tina, and I like it because it has different stuff.
Well, that's so cool. So, Lilia, can you climb up on this chair that's behind you?
Do you understand why you have to have almost the same layout, or it looks like you're walking through furniture?
I want you to jump. One, two, three, jump.
Now, this entire time, this was being recorded.
We can actually record and play back that entire session. Now, this is almost like reversing through time.
This is what your memories will look like.
It's almost like walking into a living memory that I can see through another pair of eyes from all these different perspectives. And because this is 3D content, we can miniaturize it onto this coffee table and experience it in a
more convenient manner. You can be shrinky-dinked.
And this becomes a magical way of experiencing these live-captured memories.
Game changer? Absolutely. I got to tell you a quick story here. I got to go to Redmond, try out the HoloLens, and I met one of the developers. He's a gentleman, probably early 30s. He's got two small children, age 2 and 4. And a group of us went out to dinner, and he shared with me privately. He said, I just found out I have Lou Gehrig's disease. And for those who know what that means, it's not good. And he asked Microsoft if on his off time, if he could record messages to his children that they could replay because he wouldn't be there. I said, well, what have you taped recently? He said, last night I put the 3D cameras around my car and I recorded a driving lesson for when they turn 16. A lot of people want to major in something that will help the world. They want to change the game. They want to do something to help, to cure, to help in any possible way. And a lot of people say, well, no, technology is not that. That's cold. That's impersonal. It's a game changer. It helps people more than anything. New technology is helping people hear that were born deaf. There's technology that our memories will change. And I want you to look up here. These are Glassdoor is one of the biggest companies that show trends and who's hiring in the next 5 to 10 years. So let me share with you your future. These are the top 12 jobs, not in technology, but jobs, period. What is growing the most? Look at number one, data scientist. What is that? It is a person who knows a lot about technology and data. And they look at what trends to help businesses make decisions instead of gut instinct calls. They look at the real data. Guys, you see, well, most all of these are business and technology. Did you do that just for us? No. The jobs that are growing right now are business and technology. The number one degree that more students graduated from a 4-year university in 2015, and it's already coming out to be true in 2016, you would think would be up here, right? You know, these are the jobs hiring, great pay, great everything. But the number one job, the number one degree in the United States right now that more students are graduating with is psychology. Now you say, well, we need psychologists. You've already met me. You see that I could use one, okay? But the deal is, for every 100 psychology majors, there's only one job opening, and it pays $9.34 an hour. Get a job that says, do you want fries with that? It pays better. So the point is, we put so much time taking our tests and doing well in our classes. I want you to really look at what job field is growing in this future. Are you seeing that these jobs are highly skilled, highly technology-based? Take every technology and business class that you can grab and have them keep moving forward. Because it used to be, if you just graduated from college, it didn't matter what it was in, you'd find something. But look at the jobs today. What happens to the other 99 psychology majors? They will be underemployed. So guys, I leave you with a future. I want you to look forward to the next 50 years with excitement. And I want to show us what it all looks like. Soon, if we're thousands of miles from one of our parents, we'll be able to visit them face to face, hologram and all. This is not 20 years away. This is tomorrow. And you are the generation who are going to become our inventors, changing our world. I close with this. Here's a classroom. The students are in white jackets, the teachers in gray. It's hard to tell because everyone is engaged working together. And notice today they have a guest speaker, a hologram guest speaker. Well, I want to ask you, I want to be your first hologram. We're there, baby. And soon, this is how you will interview. You and your hologram will show up. Make sure you dress for success. Our world is changing. So everyone, today is the first day of the next 50 years. In your lifetime, over those next 50 years, you will change the world. So get plugged into the future right now. New automation, new technology, but more skill than ever. You will always need to retrain, retool to move forward. Thank you so much.
So much, Corinne. Now we will take a break. You can go downstairs. We have coffee, water, and some cookies. We'll return back into the auditorium about 10 minutes till 11 for our next speaker, Mr. David Morgan. Thank y'all so much for coming, and see you at the next one.